Good morning, Elias. I see you're still connecting. That's okay. So, Joel, I think probably you or I should read the chalice lighting this morning because Elias is, I think, still learning to read, and there are some big words in the lighting.
Does that make sense? To lead it.
You would be delighted?
Yes.
Excellent.
Or I can do it.
Yeah, as long as we know who is so that we don't talk over each other, I think that's good.
John, why don't you do it? I think that would be great.
Okay. I can do it because I can remember then to turn off my video while the hymn is singing, or while the hymn is playing.
Okay.
Sometimes we forget to do that.
So Elias, if you can hear that, you'll light the chalice and John will read our chalice lighting. There we go. You're all connected now. So can you hear me? Awesome, awesome. So Elias lights the chalice and our worship associate, John Murphy, will read our chalice lighting. Sound good? I can't hear you because you're muted.
Wait,
is that better?
There we go. Yeah, there you go.
Okay, so you give us the signal to light, eh?
Yeah, you'll see, what you'll see is you'll see a slide that actually has a photograph of our chalice.
Okay.
And the chalice lighting on the wall in the background in our sanctuary, which you may have seen before. Okay. So they'll spotlight you and Elias, and Elias, you'll light the chalice then, and John will read the chalice lighting words. So you don't even have to unmute, yeah, but the camera will be on you.
It'll be okay to stay muted during that.
And then when you're done, you can turn the camera back off again. Okay?
Yep.
Awesome. You guys are all set. Thank you so much, Elias, for doing this. It was very exciting to hear that you had turned 5 this week.
What do you think of that?
You look taller already. You're going to be taller than me, aren't you?
Are you going to be taller than her?
Maybe.
Mm. Never know.
Most people are. The odds are good.
He's almost 4 feet tall.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Elias. It's okay to mute whenever you're ready. And thank you so much for doing this today.
So go ahead and mute it. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. Yeah,
that's just fine.
Okay.
N25. We all set?
Yeah, okay, so the live stream just got started. I'm gonna start some music. Elias, did you watch the Packers play yesterday?
You didn't?
Oh no, he didn't.
Oh my gosh, it was a good game. I know you're a football fan.
I said football season is all over though.
It's not, that's the playoffs right now.
Well, the Lions are all done. Nah, my mother's a Packers fan. She was watching them yesterday when we were talking to her.
Cool. Pretty cool. All right. So should we be letting people in from the waiting room? Greg, are you ready?
Give me like 1 second to start some music and put the slide deck up. But
yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay, that's good.
There's been so many things that's held us down, but now it looks like things are finally coming around.
I know we've got a long, long way to go. And where we'll end up, I don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back.
Good morning, Jane. Together,
we're polishing up our act.
Good morning, Judy.
Good morning.
Morning, Joel. Good
morning, everybody. Good morning, Doris. Good morning, Emily. Good morning, David. Good morning, Teresa. Got somebody there behind you, too. Morning, Jane.
I know you know someone that has a negative vibe. And if you're trying to make it, they only push you aside. They really don't have no. Where they're going, they don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're gonna put our
shoulders
together.
Gonna polish up our act. Morning, Caroline and John.
Up in hell down before. I know you refuse to be held down anymore.
Morning, Ellen.
Morning, Jenny.
Morning, Jerry.
Morning, Mike.
Good morning, Joel.
Morning, Ray.
Morning, Joel.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Sunday. Nice to see you all. My name is Greg Sanders, and I'm very proud to be the music director here at All Souls Unitarian Church, and also during our COVID services, your technical director. We welcome you to our service on Martin Luther King weekend. Reverend Joel Miller is presiding over today's service, a service he's called not really a service about Martin Luther King. And our worship associate today is John Murphy. If you have any questions throughout the service, I invite you to reach out to me via the chat. You can also enjoy lots of great conversation and cheers about the service with your fellow congregants and visitors in the chat feature. We recommend that you watch the service with your mute on and also in our speaker view. That tends to be the best way to observe and be a part of the service. Also know that we're broadcasting live to Facebook, so we have some friends joining us out there. So everyone be on your best behavior because the internet can see everything you're doing. So enjoy the service and thank you very much.
Welcome this morning to our service. I'm the Reverend Joel Miller. I'm the interim minister here at All Souls. So glad that we've gathered this morning. This call to worship written by my colleague, the Reverend Kristen Harper. Each day provides us with an opportunity to love again, to hurt again, to embrace joy, to experience unease, to discover the tragic. Each day provides us with the opportunity to love. This day is no different. This hour no more unique than the last, except maybe today, maybe now, among friends and fellows and journeyers, maybe for the first time, we can share ourselves. Welcome.
Good morning. I'm John Murphy, Worship Associate for today, and I welcome you to this virtual worship service of All Souls Unitarian Church. If you've joined our Zoom meeting today because you're searching for community, you have come to the right place. In a few minutes, we will light our chalice and recite the words of our covenant, which encapsulates what we're all about. As our members can attest, you'll find that All Souls is an inclusive congregation where you're encouraged to bring your whole self, including your ethnic heritage, your gender identity, and your sexual orientation. We continually renew our promise to live into our covenant. Simply put, our purpose is to put love into action. We come together to support the difficult task of overcoming fear and hatred with love and understanding. Today, more than ever, we need to connect with each other and cultivate community. Later in the service, we will display a link to an online connection card. It's a way for you to let us know of changes or concerns in your life. And it's also a way for you to participate in one or more of the current opportunities for interaction. Today, we welcome Elias Conn Clark, celebrating his fifth birthday, to light our chalice. And now I'm going to repeat the words of our covenant. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. This is our covenant. Now I invite you to listen or join in on the words of our hymn. I forget the name of the hymn, but please listen.
Gentle, angry people.
Today, the underlying theme for January worship is imagination. And today's service will also include some reflections on racism in acknowledgement of Martin Luther King Day tomorrow. Both of these subjects are on my mind today. If you're like me, the events of the past few days have captured your attention as only few past tragedies have. Like you, I watched in disbelief as violence was unleashed in the halls of Congress. However, today it's not my intention to dwell on these tragic events, other than to share a couple of personal insights. First, down in Morgan County where I live, there are lots of Trump flags, Trump bumper stickers, and MAGA hats. As a result of the recent events around the country, I find that I am more aware of these symbols. When I see someone wearing a MAGA hat or not using a mask, I can't help wondering, are they one of them? I find myself wondering if these folks knew my political and social leanings, would they wish me ill or worse? I don't know if what I'm about to say is actually true, but I can imagine that what I'm feeling in this situation may be similar to what my brothers and sisters of color might feel while immersed in a culture of white supremacy and institutionalized racism. It's certainly not hard to imagine the stress and having to constantly be on guard. Please bear with me as I explore just another thought. One that keeps buzzing around my head is the idea that while I think of those who stormed the Capitol as bad people and totally different from me. And while I think that of them, they apparently think of themselves as patriots, no matter how misguided I believe that notion to be. I'm also reminded that this country was founded on righteous acts of insurrection, sedition, and treason. Seems we humans are capable of what would normally be considered outrageous behavior if we believe strongly enough in the justness of our cause. However, it absolutely goes without saying that mob violence can never be excused or condoned. This is why I think we are wise as Unitarian Universalists to continue to follow the examples of Gandhi and Dr. Martin Luther King in utilizing peaceful, simple disobedience to bring about change wherever possible. I can only imagine how hard such an approach might seem to my Black and Brown brothers and sisters who've endured the economic and cultural disadvantage of living in a white supremacist society. And even though I have come relatively late to the party, I am determined to understand the problem and to work humbly towards naming and eliminating the vestiges of institutionalized racism in our faith and in our society.
Good morning, everyone. For those who don't know me, my name is Sarah Cannon, and I am All Souls Director of Children's and Community Programming. And Martin Luther King Jr. Day is on Monday. You probably knew that already, though. And you might have noticed that this week's Chalice pages in our Dear Families newsletter are all about the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s. If you haven't checked those out, please do. I would like to hear what you think. One of the Martin Luther King Jr. quotes I included was this one: "If I cannot do great things, I can do small things in a great way."
I think that's a really important idea because some problems, like racism, seem so big that we get tired just thinking about them, the way you might if you climbed a mountain, looked up, and saw another mountain. So let me suggest one small thing that we can do in a great way. We can believe our friends. That might sound a little bit funny because of course we believe our friends, but there are times when even though we mean to, we don't, even though we love them. Let me give you an example. Sometimes one of our friends tells us we're wrong. And I don't mean wrong about the best pizza toppings, wrong about something bigger and more important. Like maybe we tell our friend, your name is too hard to say. You should change it to something easier. And our friend says, that was hurtful. I think you're just unfamiliar with my name and names from my culture. It's not my job to change my name. It's your job to learn to say it right. Or maybe we say, ew, what are you eating? That looks weird. And our friend says, that was hurtful. This food is special to my family and my culture, and I like it. It's not my job to eat what you're eating. It's your job to be curious instead of being rude. And somewhere deep inside, we realize we were wrong, that maybe we did a racist thing. We know doing racist things is bad. And because we do care, we are afraid that doing a bad thing makes us a bad person. So we start to do this. I didn't mean it like that. You're being too sensitive. It was just an observation. You know me. You should know I'm a good person. But our friend isn't saying we're a bad person. They're telling us how we affected them. They're telling us what we need to do differently. They're giving us an opportunity to change. And that's what our UU principles tell us we should do. Our job as UUs and human beings, when our friends tell us things that are difficult to say, is to believe them. When we start defending ourselves, we put up a wall between ourselves and our friend. And we don't mean to, we're really trying to put up a wall between ourselves and hurt because we're ashamed. But we accidentally send our friends a message in that moment. And here is what it says. There are some things you can't tell me because I can't handle hearing them. So you can't be totally honest with me. It's not really safe to do that. Think about how lonely that must feel. And maybe if you're watching this story right now, maybe you've been that lonely person. Maybe something like this happened to you at All Souls. It does sometimes. We are a gentle, loving people, but sometimes we are wrong. And it's everyone's job to make sure this is a place where it is safe for you to tell people when we get it wrong. So here is something our whole community can do. When our friends say, that hurt me, or that was racist, we can train ourselves to take a breath, listen, and believe them absolutely, without question. The same way we would believe someone who said it hurt when they fell and scraped their knee. We can say, I'm so sorry, I will do better. That's it, that's the apology. We can stop right there. And if we feel that ocean of hurt coming, if we feel ashamed because we know that the thing that hurt our friend was not something we were supposed to do and not something we meant to do, and it's really scary when something sneaks up on us like that, then we can go to a friend who is not the hurt friend. Someone who is not part of the same culture or group we said the hurtful thing about. Someone who believes, like we do, and this is really important, that it's our responsibility to learn to get it right. And then we can say, I got it wrong today, and I'm so sad. You might want to check in with my friend who is hurting. And that person can listen. And then we can fourth principle it up and look up more information to make sure we really understand what we did wrong. And next time, we can choose to do better. When we do these things, we make All Souls a place where everyone can safely tell the truth. And that is definitely doing something small in a great way. Thank you.
Oh, let us turn our thoughts today to Martin Luther King and recognize that there are ties between us, all men and women living on the earth, ties of hope and love, of sister and brotherhood, that we are bound together in our desire to see the world become a place in which our children can grow free and strong. We are bound together by the task that stands before us and the road that lies ahead. We are bound and we are bound. There is a feeling like the clenching of a fist. There is a hunger in the center of the chest. There is a passage through the darkness and the mist. And though the body sleeps, the heart will never rest.
Shed a little light, oh Lord.
Shed a little light, oh Lord, again.
So that we can see
again.
Just a little light, oh Lord.
Just a little light, oh Lord.
Wanna stand it on up.
Stand it on up, oh Lord.
Stand it on up, oh Lord.
Stand on up, Lord.
Wanna walk it on down.
Wanna shed a
little light.
There is a hunger in the center of the chest. Oh, yes. There is a passage through the darkness and the mist. Oh, and though the body sleeps, the heart will never rest.
Oh, let us turn our thoughts today to Martin Luther King and recognize that there are ties between us, all men and living on the earth, ties of hope and love, of sister and brotherhood.
Good morning, All Souls. This morning, I'd like to tell you a little story. As a little girl, I learned to perform the ritual washing of Muslim wudu, the cleansing before prayer in a mosque. First the hands, then the mouth, then the nose, before pausing to state your intentions. Even after I had shifted from the faith of my childhood, I found comfort in those rituals. Ritual gives us structure to hold the things that feel too heavy or too watery or too nebulous to carry in our own hands. We do not do ritual washing in the UU tradition, but we do use ritual in this way. The joys and concerns is one way that we keep the ritual and the practice of holding one another in beloved community. We do believe that there is power in standing together in these moments. The ritual of the sharing helps us manifest that power of togetherness. And this morning, I want to hold space for a few specific griefs and a few specific joys. I lift up the passing of Milton Parks, who was also sexton for 27 years at the time of his retirement in 2018. Many of you knew and loved Milton for far longer than I knew him. He was the heart and soul of the building, and sometimes it seemed as if the building and the man were inseparable, maybe one and the same. I also hold up a specific joy this morning. Janet McCabe has been named Biden's pick for number two at the EPA. If you don't know Janet McCabe, she's passionate about the environment and passionate about doing good work. And just a wonderful and thoughtful person who I am so glad might be making decisions about our world in the upcoming months. We hold her and her family in the light this morning. So many congratulations, Janet. I also want to lift up the earthquake on the Indonesian island of Sulawesi. I grew up two major islands over from Sulawesi on the island of Java. I have many friends on the island of Sulawesi. It's a place that I hold dear as one of the most beautiful places on earth. This morning, I hold the people of Indonesia, my people, my home, and the hearts of this community, a very long way away from home, that have become my family also. Thank you for joining us this morning.
We come through the door. Perhaps we come through the door of church in someone's arms. We're small, very open to the world. We can't help but be open to the world. We need to be loved and held, fed and carried. Perhaps we've come to church as a child, holding the hand of somebody caring for us, walking in, wondering, what is this place we're coming to today? Or perhaps we've come as a youth, hoping to connect, skeptical but hopeful for greater meaning, greater purpose, a sense of belonging, with questions. Perhaps as a young adult, exploring in the world, more than skeptical, impatient with injustice, ready to change the world. Maybe a parent, caring for others, finding our days filled with the care of children, perhaps even elder parents. Perhaps we're older adults in the prime of our work, caring for the larger community, knowing the importance of justice, looking back on the lives of our parents. Or perhaps we've become elders and we walk through those doors, perhaps new to community, wondering, can we still make friends? Can we still be heard? Do we have wisdom to impart? All of us come through these doors vulnerable to one another. All of us come through these doors wishing to be known, hearing our names heard, hearing them spoken well and beautifully. There are many in this world that need us. And we have something to give them, at the very least our own selves, the beauty of our own lives, the freedom that only we can give to one another. May our vulnerability be met with love. May our love be met with openness. May our gathering be met with justice. And in a difficult time, when those who would take freedom from us, those who would take our country from us, perhaps they may hear a distant call of love, of hope, something greater. And when we have felt a despair or we feel despair, let that same call come to us. It is good to be together. Let the call of our lives ring in the silence now. Amen. All over the United States this morning, Unitarian Universalist congregations are celebrating tomorrow's holiday, the holiday celebrating the life of Dr. Martin Luther King. Every night before this service, I listen to Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech. He's standing on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, surrounded by colleagues, associates. He's speaking to 250,000 people in the mall of our Capitol. It was August of 1963. This year it was hard to listen to. Dr. King dreamt of an America that would let freedom ring. And that freedom he meant for all of us. He said, "When we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old spirit, Negro spiritual, 'Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.'" Seems very far away right now. This dream, the dream that we can be a multicultural democracy, that women can have the same freedom that men do, that we can give each other freedom. Because that dream comes alive only when we finally understand that the only freedom we will ever have is the freedom we give each other. So 10 members of All Souls Church and myself, we've been attending the Jubilee Workshop this weekend, 3 days, and they're long days. It's an intense experience. It's not an easy experience because we're listening to Black Unitarian Universalists talk about their experiences as Unitarian Universalists, as Black Americans, as human beings. And it's not easy to hear. Some of us aren't used to hearing it at all. And sometimes we find ourselves feeling ashamed. But that's not the purpose of this workshop. Not pain, not shame. Freedom, love is the purpose of this workshop. No one wants anti-racism to be painful, but in fact, the leaders of the Jubilee Workshop, they're Unitarian Universalists. Dr. Leon Spencer, who was a president of our national association, the Unitarian Universalist Association. Paula Cole Jones, she's been a Unitarian Universalist all of her life and began creating these Jubilee Workshops 30 years ago. Lutricia Keller is a family therapist. They've led many Jubilee Workshops in those 30 years. Jubilee Workshops that are updated, made new, vibrant and alive because of the people who share their lives with us. People who want to be free and who know the only way we will find it is by giving it. So I've been to Jubilee Workshops before, but I was surprised yesterday. I think perhaps after everything that's happened in the last month, maybe the last 4 years, I was surprised because I found myself in a small group and I spoke out with some vehemence, actually some anger. The anger was, I'm impatient. I get impatient. I get frustrated at the slow pace at which Unitarian Universalists throughout the United States have opened the doors to people of color, Black folks, brown folks, Asian folks. And I get angry because of how much this faith means to me, because what it has done for me. This community of people, this worldwide community of Unitarians, Universalists, Unitarian Universalists, we're all over the world. And we've saved lives in every nation. And in every congregation I've served, I've seen us save lives. And I don't mean just metaphorically, I mean literally have saved lives. And that's my own personal experience. A congregation of people in Columbus, Ohio, a city and a congregation, a lot like All Souls. The things I cherish most about myself were nurtured in that congregation. It was a wonderful gift. Freedom, love, to be cherished. And when we aren't giving it to others, there's so many others that need it, I get impatient, I get angry because I know what is possible. I became a minister because of what my congregation gave me, because of what Unitarian Universalism gives me. That's why I feel passionate about these Jubilee weekends. I want to see our faith set free too. Unitarian Universalism does not belong to us. Doesn't belong just to white people. Doesn't belong just to the folks in All Souls. It doesn't belong just to the folks who are members of Unitarian or Universalist or Unitarian Universalist congregations. It belongs to the generations. We call this a living tradition because it has ancient roots and because it will serve people into the unknown future generations. This faith belongs to life, to love, to our children's children's children. It belongs to the world. It belongs to peace and justice. Unitarian Universalism belongs to the day when all souls on earth will take hold of each other's hands and cry out together, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last. Some of you may know I was the minister of the Columbine Unitarian Universalist Church in Littleton, Colorado in 1999. Some of you may recall that there were some shootings at the Columbine High School in Littleton, Colorado in 1999. When I was at the church just two blocks away, I heard the shots and went to the police line. They sent me to care for people, and I saw terrible things. I saw wonderful things. And I saw how that church had saved lives that day, literally. But the most important thing that happened to me in those days was what happened to me the following day. The day after the shootings at Columbine High School, I went to the monthly interfaith clergy meeting for clergy in Denver who would meet with colleagues of different faiths. I arrived a little late, and when I did, the meeting stopped. There they were, ministers, rabbis, imams, priests. They gathered around me. They listened to me. They loved me. They brought me lunch. I was grateful. At the end of the meeting, I was walking out the door feeling lifted up, and the minister of the Five Points Baptist Church was waiting for me right outside the main doors of the synagogue where we met. And I remembered he'd sat quietly in the meeting. He hadn't said much. No one had brought him lunch. And it was a moment that has changed my life, perhaps more than any singular moment, more than even the shootings themselves. This colleague, minister of the AME Church in Five Points, a Baptist church, he looked me hard in the eyes. He took my hands there on the sidewalk between the front doors in the parking lot. He took my hands, looked me hard in the eyes, didn't say anything, but with his soul, he spoke all of his truth. And I knew something about that truth. The week before the shootings at Columbine, there had been shootings in his neighborhood. Five African-American boys died in shootings. And where had I read it? In those days of newspapers made out of paper and three channels, maybe four, giving the news. It hadn't been on the television news. It had been on page 5 of section 3 of the Denver Post, next to the comics. And that day when my colleagues surrounded me in love and care, no one surrounded my colleague from Five Points. I still feel a part of my soul holding his hands, his soul laid bare to me, his eyes holding fast to mine. I never remembered not only just what I'd seen in the paper, but in 1999, 13 people died every day in shootings across the United States. And the great majority of them were Black children, Latinx children, transgender children of color. Was anyone paying attention? When 12 white children and a white teacher died in a white school, was national news for years. I experienced that loss. It changed my life and was a very hard day and a hard month. For him, that was every day. Even in his pain and loss, even in his anger, he had the compassion to take my hands, look me in the eye, and share with me everything he knew about his life in that moment. He simultaneously acknowledged my pain and showed me his. He didn't shame me. He did not blame me. He didn't need explanations from me. He needed only to be loved and to let me be loved and to see my love for him. He showed me his hopes and his dreams. I saw into the depths of his soul. And I saw all those children, his children, my children, your children, our children. He didn't say anything. He let go of my hands and he walked away. And I still feel his hands in mine. He saw my humanity. And he gave me a piece of his soul, a priceless gift of love. Every Sunday we talk about service, about love. And we do this even as we have known loss and had known injustice. Dr. Takiyah Noor Amin is a Unitarian Universalist. She's a co-founder of Black Lives of Unitarian Universalism. She writes about the wisdom of Black Unitarian Universalists and our Black ancestors. Our faith, she writes, is not a confessional faith where you confess to believe. And that's the evidence of faith. The evidence of our faith as Unitarian Universalists is in the depth and quality of our relationships. The evidence of our faith is in how we love one another and support each other's full humanity. We come from justice-making work in the world, and one of the things you will learn with organizing, you don't build a model and shoehorn people into it. You center the people you are working with and working for that you are loving and cherishing. You listen deeply and build what they need to sustain their souls and to be held in love. If you ask Black people what they need, they will tell you. And so that's what 11 of us did and are doing this weekend. We're listening to our Black Unitarian Universalist people tell us what they need. And it's hard to hear. And it's easy to feel despair. It's easy to feel shame. No, that's not the hope we have. That's not the love we're called to. Dr. King, when he gave his I Have a Dream speech, he had a set of notes and he was giving, well, at that point, it was just a speech. Didn't have a name. And his manuscript on the dais in front of him had basically the notes of a meeting where a committee had decided what he would say on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial in August of 1963. It wasn't a very inspiring speech, actually. And you could see Dr. King struggling with it. People were politely applauding at one point, and he stopped, and you could see him thinking, as the 250,000 people, well, they were trying to be engaged. Behind him, his colleagues, associates, friends, especially one friend, Mahalia Jackson, the gospel singer. Gospel singer whose singing Dr. King loved and relied on sometimes in very difficult times. She called out to him from way in the back. Tell them about the dream, Martin. Tell them about the dream. And then as he listens to what Mahalia Jackson had called out to him, he pushes aside the manuscript and he's thinking. He realizes, let us not wallow in the valley of despair. When he pushed his manuscript aside and suddenly the speech was changing, many of his colleagues were alarmed because they knew he was going off script. But one colleague, Clarence Jones, remembers this moment still. He says, I turned to somebody standing next to me and I said, oh, these people don't know it, but they're about to go to church. And Dr. King began to preach. I say to you today, my friends, even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. He chose in that moment not to give in to despair, but to share a dream. We can choose not to nurture pain, but to use it and give each other freedom. We can use it to see in the eyes of our neighbors and realize what they risk to show us their love. We give ourselves to a dream like this because dreams are stronger than fear, because hope is greater than history, because relationship, it's greater than fact. It's all we have. It's life itself, and that is greater than death. This is that truth I still carry with me in the hands of my Five Points colleague in Denver. The gift of a fellow human being who set aside his fear and showed me his soul. These are the gifts that Black Unitarian Universalists are giving us in the Jubilee Workshop, and they're giving it to us again and again, making their lives prophetic, perhaps even our lives prophetic. Let us listen to our souls and listen to each other's deepest yearnings. Let us listen this morning. Let us give thanks for what we hear. Let us have a dream together and raise up our voices, open our hearts, and return the gifts we have received. So be it.
Good morning again, everyone. One of the best things that anyone who desires to be more anti-racist can do is to simply make sure that we possess a certain degree of readiness and willingness to do the work that is asked of us by people who are most affected by racism. In our chat, you'll notice a link to our weekly online connection card, which you can click and fill out at this time. This card offers you ways to engage more closely with All Souls, where we do spend a substantial amount of our time making sure that we're both spiritually ready and have the necessary skills to actually be helpful when called upon and to be in better relationship with one another as congregants, as we all come from a wide variety of cultures and life experiences. Some of the next steps that you could choose to take in the following week are to reach out to me about donating tools for our makerspace that might be languishing in your garage or basement, which helps our children move from knowing that the world is a place that we can improve to actually having the skills to do so. We're currently running an out-of-the-box contest to propose program ideas to meet the needs of our young adult community. We're also signing a petition for healthcare change if we feel so moved, which is a way of holding our local community accountable for the disparities in treatment of people from different races in our healthcare system. You could volunteer to lead our adult forum, which is currently doing quite a bit of interfaith and multi-faith learning. And you could
register for UUA's New Day Rising Conference, which is coming up on February 27th, and which actively engages us with changing white supremacy culture in our own communities and congregations. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Every week, we share the plate offering with an organization that shares our values, as you well know. This week, we are sharing our collection with Black Lives UU. Black Lives UU is a partner of the American of the Unitarian Universalist Association that calls on the Unitarian Universalist faith, a faith willing to make the bold proclamation that each person inherently matters, to live up to that claim by working towards a future in which Black lives are truly valued in our society. BLUU aims to harness love's power to combat oppression and foster healing as a spiritual and political imperative. They work to provide support, information, and resources for Black Unitarian Universalists to expand the role and visibility of Black UUs within our faith. Thank you for this, your generous support of this church and Black Lives UU.
Yeah!
Spirit of life and love, dear God of all nations, there is so much work to do. We have only begun to imagine justice and mercy. Help us hold fast to our dream of what can be. May we see hope in our history and find the courage and the voice to work for that constant rebirth of freedom and justice. This is our dream. Amen. Go in peace. Be in peace.
Good morning, everyone. As we close our service this morning, I just want to call your attention to a few announcements. If you'd like to facilitate a Soul Matters small group, say that 10 times fast, please contact me weekly at allsoulsindy.org. Currently, Ollie Howe and I co-facilitate most of the sessions, and we would love to widen our facilitation pool. If that intimidates you in any way, please do come by a few small group meetings and see that, and I hope you'll see that you're absolutely competent and 100% can do it. Our next small group meeting is coming up, and so that is January 21st, which is a Thursday, and all are welcome to join us. It's by drop-in only, no RSVPs needed, and we'd love to see you there. Additionally, the MLK in re-envisioned panel is going to be broadcast this evening. And please note the information in the order of service. That is from the Lafayette Pastors Alliance. And one of the featured presenters is Dr. Leah Gunning Francis, who has been a frequent speaker at All Souls and a local voice for justice and change. So if you are interested in that, please find them on Facebook Live or on Zoom. Additionally, we have a grant from the Center for Congregations to help us reach more young adults. And by young adults, we mean anyone from 18 to about 40. So if you have an idea for programming that you think would really meet the needs of younger people in younger congregants, please do contact us. We're currently running kind of a contest for people, for any of your ideas. We want to make your ideas reality. So please just send those in. You don't have to facilitate your own idea, but if you have something that you think would really work and you want some staff support and some seed money to make that happen, just come to me with your ideas and we can talk about it. Also, Milton's family has asked that for his memorial, we send in memories or short videos that honor his presence in our lives. You'll be getting some information in an e-blast about that memorial a little later, but for now, if you would like to have some of your memories of him read at the memorial, please contact Reverend Joel at minister@allsoulsindy.org, or you can also send them to the office@allsoulsindy.org. Thank you so much.
All right, everybody, thank you so much. We'll open up the breakout rooms in just a few minutes. We'll listen to some music and let you stretch your legs and get some coffee. We hope you have a wonderful weekend. And if you have the day off tomorrow, like many of us do, we hope you enjoy that time and give you a little bit extra chance to reflect. Archie wants to say hi, clearly. So anyway, thank you very much. Archie says hello, everyone. Thanks.
Help me, please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees.
It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will.